Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Baumgarten and Kant on Metaphysics, edited by Courtney D. Fugate and John Hymers, narrated by Bob Souer. Introduction. Courtney D. Fugate and John Hymers. Baumgarten and Kant. The relationship between Alexander Gottlieb Baumgarten, 1714-1762, and Immanuel Kant, 1724-1804, is as profound as any in the history of philosophy. In depth, it rivals such rightfully famous relationships as those between Socrates and Plato, between Aristotle and Aquinas, between Russell and Wittgenstein. More than one-third of the Academy edition of Kant's collected writings contains material related to Baumgarten, so much indeed that the editors judged it necessary to include fresh editions of three of Baumgarten's chief works alongside Kant's own, the Metaphysica, the Initia Philosophiae Practicae Primae Achromatice, first edition, and the Ethica Philosophica in both its second and third editions. With only one brief pause, Kant lectured on the Metaphysica from his first year of teaching in 1756 until his last in 1796, in total nearly 50 times over a span of four decades. The empirical psychology of the same work provided a partial basis for his groundbreaking lectures on anthropology, and so also for his important Anthropology from a Pragmatic Point of View. While Baumgarten's Initia and Ethica provided a basis for his lectures on moral philosophy, which he held at least 28 times. In logic, Kant lectured from Georg Friedrich Meyer's Vernunftlehre and Auszug aus der Vernunftlehre, both of which Kant regarded as a commentary on Baumgarten's Achroeisis, which he also owned, consulted, and recommended, and in natural theology he relied on Johann August Eberhard's Vorbereitung zur natürlichen Theologie, a textbook directly inspired by Baumgarten's Metaphysica, supplementing it with a chapter on natural theology from this latter work as well. In fact, we see from the published lectures on natural theology that Kant referred far more frequently to Baumgarten's Metaphysica than to Eberhard's Vorbereitung. This rather surprising alignment between the Coryphaeus of the metaphysicians, as Kant once called him, and the man who would turn out to be their greatest critic was no mere happenstance, but rather the result of a deliberate choice on Kant's part. Although the policies of the Prussian government required professors to lecture from an approved handbook, there remained several alternatives, and Baumgarten's textbooks were neither the most popular nor the easiest to teach from. Indeed, many of Kant's students openly preferred the shallower textbooks used by many of his colleagues. In the earliest of his lecture announcements, Kant thus felt compelled to justify his use of Baumgarten's Metaphysica in particular, explaining that despite its difficulty, this most useful and rigorous of all handbooks of its kind must be judged not by its ease but by its usefulness, reminding his students that one who would seek pearls must descend to the depths. In another announcement, published almost exactly 10 years later, Kant is still convinced that, by applying gentle pressure, he can induce A.G. Baumgarten, whose book has been chosen chiefly for the richness of its content and the precision of its method, to follow the same path. And while the critical turn surely swept away all possibility of such a rapprochement, Kant continued to employ Baumgarten's textbook and to extol its author as the chief of the metaphysicians and one of the best analysts of philosophical concepts and judgments. Indeed, when, in 1787, Kant requested a colleague to write a metaphysics on his behalf, he advised that all four classes of categories are to be treated merely analytically in accordance with Baumgarten, together with the predictables, their connection with time and space, and how they proceed, just as Baumgarten presents them. Of course, even if Kant chose Baumgarten to be his constant intellectual companion, he was at no point a slavish or even faithful disciple. In a typical reflection penned likely in the late 1770s, Kant, for instance, remarks, "Baumgarten, the man, was sharp-sighted in small things, but was not far-seeing in great things." a cyclops of metaphysicians who is missing one eye, namely critique, a good analyst, but not an architectonic philosopher, his outline of the sciences. As Kant's private notes and the transcripts of his lectures amply testify, he voiced his own ideas in true counterpoint with Baumgarten's, bringing his critical innovations to bear on traditional concepts and thereby transforming them into original insights. Even a cursory examination of Kant's personal copy of the Metaphysica is enough to convey the intensity and complexity of this exchange. Though physically a small book, Kant's miniature handwriting covers not only every bit of the pages interleaved, but also the text itself, the spaces between the lines, the margins, and even the gaps within the page ornaments. These notes, which in total amount to several times the length of the original book, provide a unique insight into how Kant evolved many of his own views through a constant correcting and reworking of Baumgarten's ideas. Their influence on Kant aside, Baumgarten's writings have long been recognized as philosophically important in their own right, and also for their role in the German Enlightenment, and for their influence on later German philosophy, particularly through the writings of Moses Mendelssohn, Thomas Abbt, Georg Friedrich Hegel, Johann Gottfried von Herder, Johann August Eberhard, Solomon Maimon, and Georg Wilhelm Friedrich Hegel, among others. As we have argued elsewhere, Baumgarten's Metaphysics in particular provided by far the richest, clearest, and most systematic attempt at reconstructing a complete metaphysical system of the kind envisioned by Leibniz and Wolff. Through its 9-period editions, 7 Latin, 2 German, Baumgarten's Metaphysica very simply came to represent the epitome of the Leibnizian branch of traditional German metaphysics. Nevertheless, the clear importance of Baumgarten's work and its relation to Kant has remained a largely unexplored topic until relatively recently, due no doubt to the absence of accurate modern translations. However, after over 2 centuries of neglect, Baumgarten's Metaphysica has now been republished in a critical Latin edition and translated into both German and English. His Aesthetica has been translated into German, while an English translation of his Initia is currently in preparation, and one of his Ethica is projected. As a result, articles, journal editions, and research projects devoted to Baumgarten are already becoming more common, and it seems we will soon reach the point where a thorough knowledge of Baumgarten's work will finally be considered indispensable for research into just about any part of Kant's philosophy. This dovetails with the current renaissance in the study of both Kant's predecessors and his lecturing activities, which is now becoming evident. Baumgarten's Metaphysics. Although Baumgarten intended the book as a text for his own lectures, today we approach the text almost exclusively as readers. To read Baumgarten's Metaphysics is not precisely to be thrown into the text as immediately and as mercilessly as one is with Spinoza's Ethics. Not precisely, but almost. Unlike Spinoza, Baumgarten provides individual introductions to the first 3 editions, an extremely detailed and somewhat analytic synopsis, and an extensive index. And yet, once we reach section 1, we are on our own. Baumgarten provides no examples, no scholia, no amplifications for his propositions. While Spinoza will occasionally step back from his tight exposition to expand leisurely on an idea, Baumgarten offers no such comfort in his extreme anticipation of Grice's maxim to avoid unnecessary prolixity. In its original language, his work confronts us with economical passage after economical passage in a text that takes full advantage of Latin's ability to avoid superfluous words, such as those providing grammatical subjects for sentences or the very nouns to which adjectives or pronouns refer. Cassila thus remarks that Baumgarten's Metaphysics is a quite extensive and complicated work that beneath its strict and highly polished surface, which is sometimes too concise like Spinoza, contains and carries complex thought composed of dense syntheses that require patient analysis. Schweiger hence begins one of his observations tellingly, when one struggles with the particularities of his Latin style, and what reader hasn't? Gallick and Crimendall detail the reception of Baumgarten's compact text, noting that although contemporary testimony praises his actual lectures, the book's extraordinary intellectual compression in presenting its subject matter and, thereby, the difficulty in comprehending it, combined with the author's writing style, are the object of almost unanimous complaints. For instance, Herder mocked its tabular method as the legacy of Baumgarten's time in the Halle orphanage, and ridiculed his barbaric language, his Neo-Latin, and in short, his forced Latin style. Barbaric also adds the connotation of an impenetrable and uncouth foreign language, such as Latin may have sounded in an era beginning to expect the vernacular. Lambert, commenting on the aesthetics, even states that knowing Latin is not enough, but rather that one must get to know Baumgarten's Latin in particular. Schweiger adds that some criticized it for being behind the times in not conforming to the growing use of the vernacular, and yet remarks that others, even Herder, cannot help but praise beyond measure Baumgarten's skill with definitions. His exemplary concise Latin original works are preferable to even the most successful German translation. Still, the contemporary reader is not in any improved position for reading Baumgarten's original works. The more that familiarity with Wolffian scholastic terminology and its whole horizon of thinking disappeared in the passage of time, the more trite became the usual blanket condemnation that his books are stiff, dry, and difficult to understand, a formulation Schweiger adopts from Julian Schmidt. The Metaphysics, though, is not just terse, it is also comprehensive. As such, Gallick and Crimendall see a certain critique of the works of Leibniz and Wolff. Leibniz's corpus is famously piecemeal, and Baumgarten's Metaphysics systematically outlines the structure and explores the content of Leibniz's Metaphysics, from the monad of his theodicy, from the universal characteristic to the ontological argument, from the universal pre-established harmony to ideal influence. As for Wolff, Baumgarten keeps a critical but still reverential distance. Wolff writes voluminous works chock full of examples, notes, and comments in an effort to expand his system to encompass all of knowledge. Baumgarten, on the other hand, explicitly refrains from Wolff's corpulent approach to texts. Baumgarten's 1,000 unadorned and densely composed Latin paragraphs offer just the bare bones of a system, as it were, and he often modestly refers to his own Metaphysics as a booklet, libellum. Baumgarten himself is well aware of his terseness, which was grounded in his single goal of providing the basic material for his own lectures. For this reason, he promises in the preface to the second edition, while addressing criticisms of his book, to add no showy ornamentations that could be pruned, or any distractions to the subject, outdoing even Aristotle in telegraphic prose. And as he says in the preface to the first edition, "Anyone who considers the matter will easily see, first, why I had to refrain in this work from repeating in writing what I usually treat with care in my lectures on rational science, and second, why I could not accomplish in a printed work what is expected of extemporaneous speakers when they lecture on a book, such that I also could have provided examples, doubts, anecdotes, and other illustrations in connecting the arguments." Baumgarten, as he continues in that same preface, simply presents a desiccated skeleton of metaphysics, albeit one whose bones are strong enough and joined well enough together. However, he says that his lectures will clothe the bare bones of his metaphysics. "Once you come to the lectures, not only will you see but also hear. Behold, the nerves grow, flesh is added, and it is covered in skin, and neither color nor life will be entirely wanting from the good lady, unless she would appear otherwise to you." Clearly, Baumgarten's plan was to resuscitate his parsimonious prose by extemporizing during his lectures. But we have no lecture transcripts from his own students, and these achromatic vamps remain silent to our contemporary ears. So, having been composed in compact Latin, being comprehensive in scope and lacking examples, the Metaphysics is a difficult read. It was no wonder that Kant's students were not happy with his choice of textbook. Kant's colleagues often chose other works, and Kant himself would sometimes choose instead to lecture on metaphysics from Baumeister's Institutiones Metaphysicae, Ontologiam, Cosmologiam, Psychologiam, Theologiam Denique Naturalem Complexiae, first published in 1738, but which went through many editions. The difficulty of Baumgarten's sparse text demanded not just eager and capable students, but also an astute lecturer. Yet despite their grumbling with Baumgarten's text, the published student notes of Kant's lectures provide a valuable set of roadmaps through the metaphysics. Baumgarten was well aware that his book was difficult. Hence, although his second preface echoes his original disdain for including examples in the metaphysics, he nevertheless mentions that his readers want and are actually expecting such supplements. I have added no examples in this edition since I have not yet changed my opinion found in the preface to the first edition. I have been asked to produce these separately, and I think this could be the more correct way to proceed. I have indeed already sketched out a sufficient number of pertinent things on paper, but I have never promised to publish any of these. Taken completely unaware, I was surprised that the catalog of the Leipzig Book Fair has actually promised examples of this sort, as if they were already about to appear at the fair. According to Golic and Kreimendahl, Baumgarten here announced an unfulfilled plan to publish a book of examples in the style of Christian Wolff's Ausführlichen Anmerkungen to the Deutschen Metaphysik. So we are left to wonder. Perhaps it was Baumgarten's early death that robbed us of Baumgarten's own commentary on the metaphysics. It is our hope, thus, that this volume goes some distance in providing the supplement that Baumgarten teased us with but never provided. This volume. We believe it is fair to say that we are only first beginning to grasp the complexity of the task before us. It will take great effort and likely also time before Kant's predecessors, Baumgarten included, are understood well enough in their own terms to allow us to judge their relation to Kant equitably. This volume aims to provide an anchor for this emerging discussion by collecting together 11 studies of Alexander Gottlieb Baumgarten's metaphysics and its relation to the philosophy of Immanuel Kant. In Baumgarten's Rationalism, which opens the volume, Brandon C. Look reconsiders the character of Baumgarten's supposed place in the rationalist tradition. As he points out, the strict opposition usually thought to hold between rationalism, empiricism, and theologically based philosophies in the 18th century tends to obscure the complexity of much of the thought of this period. In particular, he examines the historical context and substance of Baumgarten's thought, focusing on the principle of sufficient reason and Baumgarten's definition of philosophy, and shows how, in various ways, the metaphysics seeks to unify strands from all three traditions. Angelica Nuzzo's essay Determination, Determinability, and Structure of Ends, Baumgarten's Ontology and Beyond, takes us into the fundamental elements of Baumgarten's metaphysical system, the concepts of determination and determinability, and shows how his specific formulation of these concepts was fateful for the development of later German philosophy. She notes in particular that Baumgarten's formulation of these ideas fundamentally structured three key moments in German thought: the public debate on the destiny of mankind, Bestimmung des Menschen, literally determination of mankind, Solomon Maimon's development of the principle of determination, and finally, Georg Wilhelm Hegel's discussion of being in his Science of Logic. In Baumgarten's Theory of Freedom, a contribution to the Wolff-Lange controversy, Clemens Schweiger explains the key elements in the dispute between the Pietists and Wolff, and defends the thesis that as a figure situated at the boundary between these two parties, Baumgarten played a historically decisive role in the debate. To demonstrate this, Schweiger shows in detail how, in attempting to build a middle path, Baumgarten is led to offer an original and fundamental modification of the theory of freedom. This includes reworking the Wolffian concept of a rule of willing, rather developing the theory of motivational indifference and recasting the distinctions between spontaneity, choice, and freedom. With Gary Hatfield's Baumgarten, Wolff, Descartes, and the Origins of Psychology, the volume moves away from discussion of Baumgarten's relation to Pietism and the Leibnizian-Wolffian philosophy to examine its place, with particular attention to psychology, within the wider tradition initiated by Descartes. Hatfield focuses specifically on Descartes' innovative development of a mechanical psychology to complement his rationalist doctrines, and argues that while Baumgarten fails to recognize the importance of the former, he nevertheless makes several important contributions to the latter, which had a significant impact on the future of the discipline. In Between Wolffianism and Pietism, Baumgarten's Rational Psychology, Corey W. Dick, like Schweiger, also looks at Baumgarten's attempt at mediating between the Pietists and the Leibnizian Wolffian philosophy. Dick shows how this leads Baumgarten to develop an original doctrine of rational psychology that later served Kant as his primary source for the views of his predecessors. Dick devotes particular attention to original contributions Baumgarten makes to the understanding of the nature of the soul, the harmony of the soul and the body, as well as of its state before birth and after death. Rudolf A. Makriel's Baumgarten and Kant on Clarity, Distinctness, and the Differentiation of Our Mental Powers picks up the examination of Baumgarten's empirical psychology from where Hatfield's chapter left off by comparing it with Kant's discussion of the same material in his Anthropology from a Pragmatic Point of View. Through a careful analysis of both texts, Makriel shows that while Kant clearly adopts much of the structure and terminology of his own empirical psychology directly from Baumgarten, he nevertheless reworks and reorganizes these in quite different ways. According to Makriel, this can be explained by Kant's removal of empirical psychology from the realm of metaphysics and his repurposing of Baumgarten's ideas for the sake of developing a pragmatic and ultimately morally directed theory for the cultivation of the mind. In his Contradiction and Privation, Baumgarten and Kant on the Concept of Nothing, John Hymers investigates Baumgarten's identification of the principle of contradiction with a concept of nothing, in that Baumgarten defines nothing as both A and not A. After briefly looking at the historical development of the principle, Hymers shows how Baumgarten avoids Kant's complaint that the principle of contradiction is taken from experience and is thus incapable of providing a basis for metaphysics. Instead of taking the principle from experience, Baumgarten understands the principle as necessary for the possibility of experience by showing how something can only be understood as not nothing, that is, as either A or not A. Kant contests Baumgarten's exclusive identification of nothing with contradiction, and in so doing develops a quadripartite concept of nothing in the Critique of Pure Reason in accordance with the categories. Hymers accordingly argues that the first three of Kant's definitions of nothing are mere privation and not nothing. The chapter ends with an analysis of Kant's claim that Baumgarten failed to unify something and nothing in a higher concept, that of the object in general. Since Kant's object in general must only be something possible if it is that to which the categories apply, Hymers questions whether or not Kant himself was successful in unifying nothing and something in a higher concept. Courtney D. Fugate's essay, Baumgarten and Kant on Existence, re-examines Baumgarten's definition of existence with an eye to evaluating Kant's criticisms of this definition in his pre-critical writings. Fugate shows that Baumgarten sharply distinguishes existence as a specific concept from actuality as the determination with respect to that same content in a way that has gone unnoticed by previous commentators. After explaining the implications of this discovery for our understanding of Baumgarten's view of existence in general, Fugate uses it to reconstruct Baumgarten's version of the ontological argument. Fugate highlights the originality of Baumgarten's version of the argument vis-à-vis Wolff, and argues that Baumgarten's conception of existence allows him to avoid the objections brought forward by Kant in the only possible argument in support of a demonstration of God's existence. Paul Geyer's Baumgarten, Kant, and the Refutation of Idealism, which follows, points to the influence of Baumgarten's metaphysics on Kant's transcendental philosophy. By comparing Kant's refutation of idealism, including modifications to it suggested by notes written after the Critique of Pure Reason, with passages in the Metaphysics, Geyer shows that Kant clearly adopts Baumgarten's own peculiar definition of idealism, and that Baumgarten's discussion of real interaction suggested to Kant the underlying strategy of his own refutation. In Freedom of the Will in Baumgarten and Kant's ML1, Henry E. Allison continues the line of research initiated by Schweiger in this volume. Allison first returns us to the analysis of Baumgarten's understanding of freedom, pointing out, much as Schweiger does, how it seeks to continue the theory of freedom developed in the Leibnizian-Wolfian philosophy, while also avoiding what Allison calls the shadow of Spinoza, that is, the charge of thoroughgoing determinism. In contrast to Schweiger, Allison argues that what is distinctive to Baumgarten is his attempt to articulate a notion of freedom within a broadly necessitarian and rationalist framework akin to Spinoza's. By comparing this with Kant's discussion of freedom in the mid-1770s, Allison argues for a new way of understanding the relation between Baumgarten's and Kant's accounts. The volume comes to a close with Jeffrey Edwards' Wolf, Baumgarten, and the Principle of Thoroughgoing Determination in Kant's Opus Postumum, which attempts to make sense of Kant's deduction of the existence of a material ether from the principle of complete determination in his last great work, the Opus Postumum. Edwards does this by tracing the connection of Kant's understanding of the relation between existence and complete determination back to their unique formulation in Baumgarten's Metaphysics and Kant's continued development of this nexus of ideas in his own pre-critical writings. Edwards' essay shows that Baumgarten's formulation was a fundamental condition for the development of Kant's similar doctrine and that, contrary to appearances, the derivation of existence from such a principle does not, in fact, compromise the critical dimension of Kant's thought. 1. Baumgarten's Rationalism, Brandon C. Look. It is standard in the history of philosophy to place Alexander Gottlieb Baumgarten in the camp of 18th-century German Leibnizians and Wolfians and to label him a rationalist. But what precisely does this rationalism consist in? Certainly he thought that the principle of sufficient reason was one of the fundamental principles of human reasoning and of the world at large. And the explanatory and justificatory power of the principle of sufficient reason is on clear display in his Metaphysics. But the typical rationalist commitments to the nature and scope of human reason and the fundamental intelligibility of the world also bear on the question of the relation of faith and reason. In this chapter, I examine what reason and rationality meant to Baumgarten, and I explore his conception of philosophy itself in the Metaphysics. I will show that Baumgarten's rationalism is tempered by a stronger commitment to the role of faith in everyday life than that exhibited by his predecessors, Leibniz and Wolff, and, at the same time, that he had a more sophisticated picture of the nature and scope of the principle of sufficient reason than Wolff, which places him closer to Leibniz. 1. Life and Death of a Philosopher. Baumgarten was born into a pietist family in Berlin in 1714, the fifth of seven sons of the Lutheran pastor Jakob Baumgarten and his wife Rosina Elisabeth ne Wiedemann. After the deaths of his mother in 1717 and his father in 1722, Baumgarten was tutored privately in Frankfurt an der Oder until he was 13 years of age. In 1727, following the wishes of his father as dictated from his last will and testament, Baumgarten then moved to Halle, where he attended the Latin school of the famous Pietist orphanage run by August Hermann Franke. 3 years later, he matriculated at the university with the intention of studying theology, again according to the wishes of his late father. The University of Halle had, of course, become a stronghold of pietism by this time, having run Christian Wolff out of town several years earlier. And Baumgarten's teachers in theology included Joachim Lange, one of the most vocal opponents to the Wolffian philosophy, as well as Gotthilf Franke, the son of Augustus. While Alexander had been exposed to the philosophy of Wolff and the other schools of philosophy by his elder brother Sigmund Jakob during his time in the Weissen House, his interest in philosophy continued to grow while at university. By 1733, Baumgarten's interest in philosophy, and presumably specifically the Wolffian philosophy, had been sufficiently piqued that he started traveling to Jena to hear lectures by Reusch and others. In the preface to the third edition of the Metaphysics, Baumgarten regards his good fortune in having grown up in such an atmosphere. Having grown up surrounded by others hostile to this way of philosophizing, that is, the philosophy of Leibniz and Wolff, I first imbibed almost exclusively whatever could be objected to it, rather than its own doctrines. It so happened that I made some, no, on the contrary, many, of these same teachings my own, but only after an intense and careful investigation of the truth. Indeed, it seems that Baumgarten began to be regarded as something of a Wolffian himself. In his Philosophische Briefe von alle Theophilus, he reports the following anecdote. After dinner conversation turned to proofs of the reality of God, and I said, in all honesty, that I preferred the proof from contingency and the proof from the concept of the most perfect being, when this is understood correctly. An elderly scholar, ein betagter Academicus, who had joined us, retorted that one could find many more proofs among the apologies for God against the atheists. I agreed to this assessment of the arguments against the atheists, but added in a rush, "Not all apologies for God are theodicies." He pulled back, harumphed, and said, "My dear sir, I see that for you Leibniz and Wolff are beginning to surpass not only the Pandects, but even the Bible itself. Where is this leading? You will not remain with the Wolffians, which is what you are now. I worry, ich sorge, ich sorge." Despite his apparent Leibnizian and Wolffian tendencies, Baumgarten was asked to give lectures on logic at the Halle Weissenhaus. While the textbook was officially the Elementa Philosophiae Rationalis et Moralis of Heineccius, Baumgarten drew heavily on Wolff's logical texts. Indeed, a year later, as it again became permissible to teach Wolff's philosophy, he began to lecture publicly in Halle on his Vernunftlehre. In 1735, Baumgarten completed the requirements for his master's degree, but shortly thereafter began showing signs of tuberculosis, his ultimate cause of death. Nevertheless, he was lecturing more regularly at the university in Halle on a host of issues in metaphysics, logic, ethics, law, and theology, using, among other works, Gottsched's Erste Gründe der gestammten Weltweisheit, another treatise in the growing body of works in the rationalist tradition. In 1739, as we all know, Baumgarten published the first edition of his Metaphysica, and in 1740 he began his career at the University of Frankfurt-Oder, where he remained until his death in 1762. The details of Baumgarten's life are widely available and fairly well known to scholars of the period. The story of his death and the reactions to it, however, are less familiar, and they are both amusing and philosophically interesting. According to Meyer, Baumgarten gave an example of how a Christian philosopher could die. On his deathbed, Baumgarten is purported to have said, "Serenitas animi est demonstratio demonstrationem." This has Christ alone. Reason knows nothing of this. He banned all scholarly works from his bedroom and pronounced that, "Whoever speaks to me of this has my hatred." And on his last day, when asked if his soul had found peace, Baumgarten responded, "Yes, this has Christ alone. On this point, neither the philosopher nor the theologian helps, only faith alone. My old faith, mein alter Glaube, with which I die is demonstratio demonstrationem. My heart trusts in God through Jesus Christ. That is my confession of faith. That is my confession of faith after all symbolic books of the Lutheran faith." Not all found this story of Baumgarten's deathbed returned to his faith moving. Moses Mendelssohn, for example, described this episode to Thomas Abbt as a mythologic death, writing that Baumgarten's final rejection of the claims of rational knowledge was in no way to be excused. If reason is not holy enough to keep us company in our hour of death, and when we pass to close our eyes, why do we wait so long? You should just ban this stubborn reason early from its activity, and so live the way you plan to die. If I knew that the hour of my death could lead me to such a view of reason, then, in that moment, I would just cast aside the entire plunder known as philosophy and prepare myself to die. For his part, Thomas Abbt summarized the views among his contemporaries toward Baumgarten's deathbed utterances in the following way. To some, it seemed the highest triumph of the Christian religion. To others, feeble-mindedness and hypocrisy. My own sympathies are on the side of Mendelssohn and all those who find Baumgarten's views on his last days pure Schwachsinn. But either way, let us ask the following questions. In what sense was Baumgarten ever a rationalist? What does rationalism mean in his case? What does it mean in general in 18th century German philosophy? In my view, Baumgarten always occupied a position that one can, with a straight face, describe as being rationalist pietist. In fact, I think that the opposition between rationalism and pietism is often overstated. But that is a larger story for another occasion. Now, it is certainly not altogether new to point out Baumgarten's connection to pietism throughout his life. Nor is it altogether novel to suggest that Baumgarten is much closer to Leibniz than Wolff ever was. And yet, these two views of Baumgarten, the pietist rationalist who was at the same time close in spirit to Leibniz, stand in some tension, not least because Leibniz rejected offers to see a pastor in his final days and died with a book in his hands and not the Bible. 2. Rationalism in context. The term rationalism was not a term that philosophers of the early modern period used. It belongs, of course, to later historiography. Kant makes a distinction between empiricists and rationalists concerning the principle of taste in the Critique of the Power of Judgment. He also makes a distinction between rationalists and materialists in the Critique of Pure Reason in the refutation of Mendelssohn's proof of the permanence of the soul. But it is in the Opus Postumum and the Reflexionen that one sees more clearly the kind of picture of rationalism that one also gets in our undergraduate accounts of the history of modern philosophy. Rationalism is, Kant tells us, where one derives everything a priori. In the Religion, too, Kant employs the term as well, contrasting rationalists with naturalists and supernaturalists. And it was really, of course, Hegel and the Hegelian school of the history of philosophy who liked to draw the contrasts between rationalism and pietism, or rationalism and empiricism. These two pairs naturally point to two distinct ways of thinking of the nature of rationalism. In the first case, rationalism, in a strong sense, is said to be or to contain the view that reason alone can lead us to the truth. In other words, faith was not a unique guide to truth. Put in a slightly different way, one could say that rationalism denies the view that faith can lead us to truths that are themselves without a rational grounding. In fact, however, this view is too strongly drawn. Leibniz, for example, always publicly writes as if there are mysteries of faith that are to be accepted even when we cannot understand them. The contrast between rationalism and empiricism, on the other hand, is related, but one could see the distinction as centering solely on the origin of our ideas. The empiricist maintains that all our ideas have their origins in sense impressions. The rationalist claims that not all our ideas are traceable to sense impressions, for some ideas are innate. Moving past this almost undergraduate-level view of the nature of rationalism, we might also say that 18th-century German rationalists endorsed the principle of sufficient reason and used it to draw any number of strong consequences from it. These philosophers were opposed by others, for example, Crucius, who sought to proscribe the use of this great principle of all our reasonings, as Leibniz says in the Monadology, section 31. The supposed fact that there was a sufficient reason for everything is just another way to express the view that the world is fundamentally intelligible and the creation of a being with rational powers. It also reflects the view that our intellectual powers are presumably like those of the Creator, if only more limited. It is for this reason that Wolff, for example, says that God is the absolutely highest philosopher, philosophus absolute sumus. It is my view that Baumgarten endorsed all these claims in one form or another, but so did Leibniz and Wolff. In what follows, however, we will see that Baumgarten differed from his two great predecessors in some important ways. In other ways, though, he remained much closer to Leibniz than to Wolff. In order to make this clear, let us look first at the very conception of the nature of philosophy and metaphysics in the works of these authors. 3. The nature of philosophy. We can see a difference between Baumgarten and Wolff simply concerning the question of the nature of philosophy and the nature of metaphysics. For his part, Wolff famously defined philosophy, Weltweisheit, in the preliminary discourse of his German Logic as a science of all possible things, how and why they are possible. It is only natural that Wolff, who thought of God as the highest philosopher, should consider philosophy itself as a scientia possibilium, as it was then called in the Latin logic. For Wolff, as for Leibniz, God surveys all possibilia, considers their qualities, and opts for the best world. Metaphysics, in turn, is defined by Wolff as the science of being, of the world in general, and of spirits. Natural theology, a subject that will come up later, is the science of those things that are possible through God. By contrast, in his 1741 work, Gedanken vom vernünftigen Beifall auf Akademien, Baumgarten claims that philosophy is a science of those qualities of things that can be known without faith. And in the Metaphysica, he breaks from Wolff with his definition of metaphysics as well. Metaphysics is the science of the first principles in human knowledge. On the other hand, on a superficial level, Baumgarten keeps to the divisions within philosophy laid out by Wolff and Tuming, claiming that metaphysics comprises ontology, cosmology, psychology, and natural theology. Nevertheless, it does not take much to see how Baumgarten's conception of metaphysics could play a role in Kant's thinking about the discipline. Metaphysics is not first and foremost a science of being in the classic Aristotelian or even Wolffian sense. Metaphysics already concerns the nature of human knowledge and, presumably, its limits. It seems to have almost a Cartesian touch to it, placing the knowing subject at its center. Now, the actual book, The Metaphysics, does not proceed in a Cartesian manner, but neither does it really proceed in a Wolffian manner. As Baumgarten tells us in the Prolegomena to Part 1, ontology is the science of the more general predicates of a being. The more general predicates of a being are the first principles of human knowledge. Therefore, ontology rightly belongs to metaphysics. And even though the ontology is part one of the metaphysics and concerns the possible, even here Baumgarten phrases this in very cognitive and subjective terms. That which is not nothing is something. The representable, whatever does not involve a contradiction, whatever is not both A and not A, is possible. The representable is, in other words, that which exhibits some predicate or quality, obviously, and philosophy is the science that examines those qualities independently of faith. It is also helpful to compare Leibniz's position on this matter. While he does not give us a nice, pithy definition of philosophy as do Wolff and Baumgarten, he does, of course, have a lot to say about the relation between reason and faith. In the opening section of the preliminary dissertation on the conformity of faith with reason from the Theodicy, he writes the following: I assume that two truths cannot contradict each other, that the object of faith is the truth that God has revealed in an extraordinary manner, and that reason is the connection, enchainment, of truths, but especially, when compared with faith, of those which the human mind can attain naturally without being aided by the light of faith. Baumgarten, too, believes in the connection of all truths through reason. In fact, as we will see, the principle of sufficient reason means that there will be a connection among truths. It is here that ratio functions as both reason and ground. The faculty of reason determines the connections of truths, and these truths have their reasons. 4. The principle of sufficient reason. The principle of sufficient reason. The principle of sufficient reason occupies a central place in the thought of Leibniz, Wolff, Baumgarten, and others, and, as I have suggested, much of what it means to be a rationalist is simply placing great weight on this principle in the development of one's philosophical system. While Leibniz had claimed the principle of sufficient reason to be one of the two great principles of all our reasoning, he generally does not offer an argument for this principle in his mature published works. But in his early writings from the 1670s, for example in his Confessio Philosophiae of 1676 and his short piece from the same year, De Existentia, he does offer a justification for the principle of sufficient reason. For existence, it is necessary that the aggregate of all requisites is present. A requisite is that without which a thing cannot exist. The aggregate of all requisites is the full cause of a thing. There is nothing without a reason, for there is nothing without an aggregate of all requisites. And at the end of his career, Leibniz expresses a similar thought in his correspondence with Clark, a text that all philosophers of the 18th century knew, writing, 'Tis very strange to charge me with advancing my principle of the want of a sufficient reason without any proof drawn either from the nature of things or from the divine perfections. For the nature of things requires that every event should have beforehand its proper conditions, requisites, and dispositions, the existence whereof makes the sufficient reason of such an event.' This is not really much of a proof or demonstration of the principle of sufficient reason, but it is about all that Leibniz was interested in giving to Clark. If there is an argument for the principle of sufficient reason in Leibniz's philosophy, it is rather to be found as following from his In Esse account of truth. This is apparent when one considers his short piece now usually called Primary Truths. But as Leibniz learned from his correspondence with Arnauld, this account of truth was not in itself above reproach, no matter how obvious it seemed to Leibniz himself, and he rarely made reference to the connection between his account of truth and the principle of sufficient reason in his published writings. One exception to this rule is a comment buried in the appendix to the Theodicy in which Leibniz treats William King's essay on the origin of evil. There one finds the following remark: "There are two great principles, namely that of identicals or of contradiction, which states that of two contradictory enunciations the one is true and the other false, and that of the sufficient reason, which states that there is no true enunciation whose reason could not be seen by one possessing all the knowledge necessary for its complete understanding. Both principles must hold not only in necessary but also in contingent truths, and it is even necessary that that which has no sufficient reason should not exist. For one may say, in a sense, that these two principles are contained in the definition of the true and false." Indeed, Christian Wolff seems to have overlooked this point, suggesting that Leibniz had no demonstration of the principle of sufficient reason. As he writes in section 30 of the German Metaphysics, "Mr. Leibniz proved the importance of this principle, first in our times through beautiful examples, Proben, in his Theodicy, as well as in the letters that he exchanged with the Englishman Clark concerning several disputed points. He accepted it as a principle grounded in experience to which there is no contrary case, and thus no demonstration of it, even though Clark had demanded one." Wolff and Baumgarten both attempt to provide arguments for the principle of sufficient reason, both arguing that it can be shown to follow from the principle of contradiction. But the arguments are not particularly helpful or convincing. I will not discuss Wolff's argument, rather I wish to go directly to Baumgarten's argument. As mentioned, Baumgarten has a definition of that which is something, the representable, whatever does not involve a contradiction. In the previous section, Baumgarten had given his definition of nothing, that which is both A and not A. As he puts it, "There is no subject of contradictory predicates, or nothing both is and is not. This proposition is called the principle of contradiction, and it is absolutely primary." In section 10, Baumgarten presents the principle of excluded middle, every possible thing is either A or not A. And in section 14, we find the rather important definition of a ratio, that from which it is knowable why something is. The argument for the principle of reason or the principle of ground now comes in section 20, where Baumgarten writes the following: "Everything possible either has a ground ratio or does not. If it has a ground, something is its ground. If it does not have one, nothing is its ground. Therefore, the ground of every possible thing is either nothing or something. If nothing were the ground of some possible thing, it would be knowable, cognoscibile, from nothing why that thing is, and hence the nothing itself would be representable and something, and nothing would be something. Hence, something possible would be impossible. Therefore, something is the ground of every possible thing, which is to say, everything possible is a consequence, rationatum, which is to say, nothing is without a ground, nihil est sine ratione, or when something is posited as its ground. This proposition is called the principle of ground. Haec propositio dicitur principium rationis." This argument is far from convincing. The premises cited by Baumgarten, for example, do not exactly work in the way he suggests, but it is clear that the argument is supposed to depend upon the principle of contradiction. The argument fails, however, because of Baumgarten's problematic reference to nothingness. For the crucial move in the argument is this: if nothing is the reason for some X, then that nothing is being represented as the reason for X. But whatever is representable is something and not nothing. Therefore, nothing is something, and we have generated the contradiction for the reductio. It is difficult to imagine being moved by this argument. Indeed, I cannot help feeling that Schopenhauer had things right in his fourfold root of the principle of reason when he wrote of the pointlessness of the search for an argument for the principle of sufficient reason. To look for a proof of the principle of reason, Satz von Grunde, is moreover a special kind of wrongness, Verkehrtheit, showing a lack of common sense. Every proof, namely, is the explanation of the reason, Grundes, for a distinct judgment, which just through this obtains the predicate true. The principle of reason is the expression of precisely this demand for a reason, Grundes, for every judgment. He who now demands a proof of the principle, that is, an explanation of a reason, hereby assumes it simply already to be true, indeed bases his demand on this assumption. He falls into the circle that he demands a proof of the warrant to demand a proof. In the third edition preface to the Metaphysica, Baumgarten brings up arguments in response to criticisms of the Principium Rationis, or Satz vom Grund, and wonders if the principle might not be an identical proposition, not requiring a proof at all. He says, "You demand a proof, or rather a demonstration. Which one? What if I counted the principle of ground among the undemonstrable propositions, that is, those propositions of which you would become completely certain as soon as the mere terms are understood? Your denial of certitude will not refute me, for what if you have not yet understood the terms, that is, what if you confuse the ground and the sufficient ground?" It seems, therefore, that Baumgarten is aware of the issues relating to the justification of the principle of sufficient reason in a way that Wolff is not. He even sees part of Schopenhauer's point, but turns it around. For Schopenhauer had said that the person who demands a proof of the principle of reason assumes it in asking for its justification. Baumgarten presents this point as a criticism from others of the argument for the principle of reason and claims that, in fact, he is not presupposing it. I have discovered some learned men calling this demonstration into doubt in two ways. First, some of them hold that a ground of everything possible is already presupposed in that very demonstration, although it is still in question. Very well, let's see what presupposed, which is ascribed to me, may mean here. I think that I, sensibly, presuppose only those things that I judge to exist, or at least to be possible. Now I ask you, let us carefully read over the demonstration to see whether in it I ever judge that the ground of something possible is possible before the apagogic demonstration is completed, that is, before I have shown that something without ground is contradictory. When I say this ground is either nothing or something, I certainly am not presupposing nor even judging to be possible what I explicitly state with a disjunction to be either impossible or possible. Thus, I really consider the ground of every possible thing to be totally indeterminate throughout the demonstration, and I did not determine its possibility until the conclusion of the demonstration finally indicated that it must be necessary. The critical issue that Baumgarten acknowledges is the universality of the principle. Perhaps one could say there are some things for which there is not a sufficient reason why it is so, and not otherwise. But the principle of sufficient reason itself had better have a reason why it is true. On the other hand, we don't want to get to the position where we are saying there is a reason for everything except for the principle of sufficient reason and God. While Baumgarten points to the differences between ground simpliciter and sufficient ground or sufficient reason, for our purposes this is not significant. What is significant is the claim in section 19 where Baumgarten claims A, that everything is connected, which will become tied up with the claim that everything has a reason or ground, and B, that the connection is rationale or grounded. This should not be surprising given the definition in section 14 of ground as that through which something is knowable or cognizable why it is. At the same time, it is perhaps moderately surprising that this does not play an explicit role in Baumgarten's argument for the principle of reason. The foregoing should suffice concerning Baumgarten's conception of and argument for the principle of reason. Again, while Baumgarten officially, as it were, in the text of the Metaphysica, gives an argument that bears some superficial resemblance to the arguments advanced by Wolff, at the same time, he also suggests that the principle of reason is an identical proposition and an axiom, requiring no justification. In this sense, he seems to come closer to Leibniz. These differences are all minor, however. Leibniz, Wolff, and Baumgarten are all clearly in the same camp on the core issue, the universality of the principle of sufficient reason. And this is, of course, part of what it means to be a rationalist. While Kant will not really employ the term rationalism to describe the commitment to the universality of the principle of reason, it is, of course, bound up with the dogmatic use of reason. As we all know, for Kant, the faculty of reason seeks the completeness of a system, and for thinkers like Leibniz, Wolff, and Baumgarten, this completeness is tied up with the conception that everything has a ground, that everything is connected. 5. Reason and Faith. This chapter began with the story of Baumgarten's supposed mythologic death. Let us return to this subject now. What is it that faith could give Baumgarten that philosophy could not? Does Baumgarten's death really show that he rejected reason and philosophy? One might be able to read the story of his death as simply confirming a certain faith that he always had, one in which there were certain truths that unaided human reason could not show us. Perhaps this is consistent with what one finds in the Metaphysica. All truths are connected in the mind of God, and God can reveal certain truths to the minds of men, but they are not all discoverable by human beings. The three philosophers who have been at the center of this paper, Leibniz, Wolff, and Baumgarten, are all committed to the conformity of faith and reason. Following Leibniz, for example, Wolff claims that something is above reason if it cannot be demonstrated from the principle of reason, whereas that which is contrary to reason conflicts with the principle of reason. But further, in the natural world, there simply is nothing that is above reason, for everything in the natural world is explicable with reference to the principle of sufficient reason. This does not mean that we, finite human beings, will be able to understand everything. It does not mean that we can grasp all reasons for all things. But it does mean that in principle we could, for everything is governed by the principle of sufficient reason. That is, we could do so if our cognitive capacities were greater than they are and approaching the infinite intellect of God. Indeed, one could go further and claim that, for the rationalist Baumgarten, this must be so, since the world is the product of the divine and rational mind. To assert that the infinite and omniscient being God is a rational mind is not to assert that the being is in some sense super smart. It is to assert that there is a reason for everything, that all truths have grounds. Ultimately, these reasons or grounds will also be tied up with the benevolence and justice of God. As we have seen, Baumgarten would seem to endorse precisely this position as well. After all, he advocates the position that everything in the natural world is connected, hence grounded and rational. But he also allows for the possibility of miracles. His characterization of the supernatural is close to that of Leibniz. It is when an event does not follow from, that is not grounded in, the essence of the contingent things of the world. His argument that miracles and the supernatural are possible is just this: the natural and naturally ordinary are contingent in every world. There is a possible world in which there are events that arise from a source other than the essences of contingent beings. Therefore, miracles are possible. And in Baumgarten's view, as opposed to the view of the naturalists, this world might be one in which there are miracles. For we know that God chooses the best of all possible worlds, and that, as Baumgarten tells us, in section 441, in the most perfect world there is the greatest universal nexus, harmony, and agreement that is possible in a world. To understand the role of faith and its relation to reason in Baumgarten's life and philosophy, we also have to look at the place of revelation in his metaphysics. The work, in fact, concludes with a discussion of the last branch of metaphysics, natural theology. There he defines revelation in the strict sense as divine supernatural revelation given to humans through speech, and claims that it is actual in this world whenever religion cannot be actualized equally well through natural revelation alone. There is, according to Baumgarten, nothing contrary to reason in revelation and faith. Revelation, in the strict sense, signifies supremely possible things. Now, those things which go against reason are impossible. Therefore, neither revelation, either in the strict or the strictest sense, nor holy faith taken objectively, go against reason. Indeed, those things that go against reason are not the revelation of God, either in the strict or the strictest sense, nor are they holy faith taken objectively. This account allows Baumgarten to conclude that naturalists and atheists are in error. A naturalist, in the stricter sense, denies the revelation of God in the strict sense in this world. The theoretical atheist denies the existence of God and errs. In neither sense does naturalism necessarily maintain atheism. And he concludes the entire book thus. If naturalists in the stricter sense deny that revelation in the strict sense exists in this world because, 1, it is a supernatural event, and hence seems impossible, because, 2, they believe holy faith to be against reason and hence impossible, or, 3, because they deny divine providence over the human race, then they err through their own fault and are ignorant of the most benign God, whose honor, name, and praise shall always remain. The point should be clear. Baumgarten is trying to maintain a commitment to rationalism, understood as, among other things, a commitment to the principle of sufficient reason.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.